so much this morning. I'll ask if you would to turn to the Gospel of Luke, chapter 9. If you're using the Pew Bible, I think it's page 1611. Page 1611, or Luke chapter 9. We'll begin at verse 51. Several weeks ago, someone came out of the office and wanted to talk to me about the heart of God. What makes God sad? And we had a really involved discussion and enjoyed it. This morning, let's take for a moment just to look a little bit at the heart of God. Now, this is a very interesting passage of Scripture, and it's one of those that, you know, if I were writing the Scriptures, you know, it helps us to understand how true the Bible is, because this is one of the places where a couple of the disciples looked bad, you know. And they could have just as easily left this out, sort of cover their tracks, but they didn't. And so we find in verse 51, "And it came to pass, when the time was come that he should be received up, he steadfastly set his face to go to Jerusalem, and sent messengers before his face, and they went and entered into a village of the Samaritans to make ready for him. And they did not receive him, because his face was set as though he would go to Jerusalem. And when his disciples, James and John, saw this, they said, Lord, wilt thou that we command fire to come down from heaven and consume them, even as Elias did? Now Jesus is on his way to Jerusalem. They're going through Samaria. And as he often did, he sent a couple of the disciples, we don't know what it was, one, two, three, but he sent some of the disciples to go and make arrangements. Now we don't know what the arrangements were, whether he just wanted to make arrangements for a meal, or a place to spend the night, or a place to preach and heal for a couple of days, but we know that Jesus sent these disciples into this village in Samaria, and somehow or another they knew that Jesus was not going to stay there long. His face was set, he was on his way to Jerusalem, and he was just going to be passing through their village. And they said to the disciples, we don't want you. If you're not going to come and stay a while, we'd just as soon you not stop in our village. And so James and John says to Jesus, hey, they just insulted you. Can we call down fire from heaven and just zap this place? I mean, Elijah did that. Can't we do that? Now, there's no doubt that if Jesus had given them the go-ahead, and that Jesus would have given them the power, and it could have been done. What a spirit of destruction. We see that all around us today. People who think they're standing up for God by killing others. Whether it's here in America or whether it's overseas. People who think, I'm doing God a favor by killing people that aren't like me. We've had people walk into church, kill others. We've had people walk into concerts, kill others. They think they're doing God a favor. Now, you know, when we think about it, we go down here and we invite somebody to come to church with us. If they say no, we say, I'll pray for you. And we may go back later, but we don't go down and blow up their house. But that happens all over the world. That spirit of destruction, that spirit of evil, that spirit that says, I want to deal with people that aren't like me. But let's look at the heart of God. Verse 55. And he says, but he, and that's talking about Jesus, turned and rebuked them and said, you don't know what manner of spirit you are of. He said, you've got the wrong idea. You've got the wrong spirit. Something is not right in your heart. For the Son of Man is not come to destroy men's lives, but to save them. And they went to another village. Jesus said, I am not come to destroy, but to save. I have not come to obliterate people, but to draw them to God. You think about the many, many ways that Jesus saved. He saved people's physical bodies as he touched their bodies and brought healing. He brought families together. He brought men and women and boys and girls into a right relationship with the Heavenly Father. He comes to save, not to destroy. Out of his great love for us, Jesus comes to draw us to himself and to create in our heart a love for others. You realize that a few weeks ago, those of you, I think most of you in the adult classes, Sunday school lesson, dealt with Matthew 25, where the Lord says to those on his right hand, come into the kingdom. You visited the sick, you visited the prisons, you fed the hungry, you clothed the naked, you ministered to those who were hurting. That's the spirit of Jesus. The spirit that says, I have come to be a blessing. I have come to minister to people who are hurting in every way. Ever start to think that if you go back in history, hospitals were started by Christians. Orphanages were started by Christians. Most of the great universities were started, even if they were hundreds and hundreds of years old, started by Christians. The whole idea was to go in the name of Jesus and minister to hurting people around the world. And you see, whenever you go to that neighbor that's hurting, a sickness, a problem, and you go and you love them in Jesus, you're being like your Savior. When you give to missions and you're trying to bring people to Jesus around the world, you're being like Jesus. When you go to that lost neighbor or that lost co-worker and try to explain to them the difference between heaven and hell, and the difference between the joy of heaven and the terribleness of hell, and you invite them to become a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ, you are being like Jesus. You see, Jesus was saying, oh, James and John, my heart, the heart of God is not to destroy people, but to restore them, to love them, to draw them in, to save them, to save them. On another occasion, Jesus said about himself, I've come to seek and to save the lost. On another occasion, Jesus talked about the parable, or he told the story of the 99 that were saved. He said, there was one lost sheep, and the master went out to seek that sheep. The shepherd went out to seek that sheep, to bring that one lost sheep back into the fold. And said, when he found it, put it on his shoulders, and came back rejoicing. Rejoicing. You may be here this morning. You wonder, does God love you? Does God care about you? Yes, he does. If you are the only lost person in this building, Jesus wants to save you. If you are the only hurting person in this building, Jesus wants to minister to you. If you're the only confused person needing direction in your life, Jesus through the Holy Spirit wants to direct you. He came to seek and to save the lost. And in a congregation like this, we might say, well, must I believers? And if the trumpet should sound and the rapture should happen at this very moment, most of us would be gone from here. But if you're the one person that would not, Jesus says, come to me. Come to me. I'll forgive your sin. I'll draw you to myself. You see, Jesus so loves you. He has no hate. He has no spirit of destruction. He has a spirit of love. And he says, it's a different spirit that draws men and women to himself. And he wants to meet us right where we are. You might say, I'm a young person. I've not really done anything bad. You know, when I became a Christian, I hadn't murdered anybody. I hadn't taken any drugs or anything else. But he loved me and he saved me. Or you might be an older person and you say, well, preacher, you just don't know what I have done. How bad it's been. That's why the words and the testimony of the Apostle Paul are so good. In one case, Paul says, listen, so I was the chiefest of sinners. And he goes on to explain, if Jesus could save me, everybody else would be scared. He said, I was the worst, so everybody else was better than me, even though they were sinners. And so if he could save me, he could save you. Good news that he came not to destroy. He came not to destroy, but to save. You know, we live in a world that likes to hate and a world that likes to destroy. But Jesus loves and he wants to save. And over in John's letter, the first John chapter 4, because the same John that said, Lord, let's call down fire from heaven on these folks. Let's burn them to a crisp. This same John said in verse 7, beloved, let us love one another. For love is of God. Everyone that loveth is born of God and knoweth God. Beloved, verse 11, if God so loved us, we ought also to love one another. John had grown in his faith. John had grown in his relationship with Jesus. John had come to a place in his life where no longer was he that angry disciple who wanted to destroy. But he was a man of love who wanted to exhibit the heart of Jesus in the way he loved and in the way he challenges us to love. You see, the more you love, the more like Jesus you are. The more you love, the more like Jesus you are. The more you love your brothers and sisters in the church, the more like Jesus you are. The more you love your brothers and sisters who may not be a part of our church, but are a part of the family of God, the more like Jesus you are. The more you love lost people, the more like Jesus you are. The more you love hurting people, the more like Jesus you are. What a transformation from a man who wants to call down fire from heaven to a man who says, brother, let's demonstrate our relationship with Jesus by our love. What is the heart of God? The heart of God says, I love you so much that I gave my son for you. Will you love me in return? Brad, would you come down? Give you a Bible, and it's not to take home, put on the shelf, and 35 years from now say, hey, this is the Bible they gave me when I got baptized. It's to take it home and read it and study it and let it help you grow as a believer in Jesus Christ. And wear it out, because when you graduate from high school, we'll give you another one. And when you wear that one out, we'll give you another one when you graduate from college. I think the tradition is. So go ahead and wear it out. Start with the gospel, read the gospels, and that'll help you to grow in the Lord. All right. If you want to go and get ready to be baptized, we're going to have a time of invitation. If you've never received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, we invite you to do that. There's other decisions you need to make this morning, something that's on your mind and heart. God speak to your heart. You need to come to the altar. Remember, if you were the only one here today without Jesus, he loves you. He's excited about the 99 that are saved, but he doesn't want you to leave lost. So if you're here without Jesus, would you come as we stand to sing?
Let's stand and sing our invitation hymn, the New Cross of Jesus.
Jesus.
Church in South Carolina. Is there a motion you receive with this letter?
So moved. Second.
All in favor of an uplifted hand? Any opposed? And I don't see any. So if you'll sit here, and after this time, we're going to sing another song while I go get ready for the baptism. You baptize Bradley, and then after the benediction, you come by and speak to Candace and welcome her into the fellowship of the church. All right, let's be seated.
You will now stand and join us in singing, "Shall We Gather at the River?" Standing as we sing.
Oh,
this place.